عليكم ورحمة الله. لعل ضغوط الحرب الباردة ما زالت مستعرة اليوم، وقد تكون الضربة القاسمة للاتحاد الأوروبي الهش والناتو، مع مدير المركز الألماني للدراسات الأوراسية مانويل أوكسنرايتر. نستشرف حال ألمانيا الجيوسياسية وعلاقاتها الخارجية، ولا سيما العلاقة مع روسيا والاتحاد الأوروبي من الداخل. معكم زينب صفار، تابعونا. حركها الرئيس الروسي فلاديمير بوتين خلال لقائه مراسلي الصحافة الأجنبية في ختام أعمال المنتدى الاقتصادي العالمي الذي عقد في سان بطرسبرغ في حزيران يونيو المنصرم، حيث وجه سهامه ضد الصحفيين الأجانب وسردياتهم ومانعتها بالروايات الطويلة التي تكرر الأكاذيب العمياء والتضليل الذي تقدمه الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية عن منظومتها المضادة للصواريخ الباليستية التي تنشرها في أوروبا الشرقية. واتهم الإعلاميين الأجانب بأنهم يروجون لحرب نووية وحرب عالمية ثالثة. وما يجعل احتمال نشوب حرب نووية أكثر خطورة حملة إعلامية موازية ضد الصين بحسب المتابعين، فنادرا ما يمر يوم لا يشار فيه في الإعلام الغربي إلى ارتقاء الصين إلى مرتبة تهديد. فبحسب الأميرال هاري هاريس قائد القوات الأمريكية في المحيط الهادئ، الصين تقوم ببناء جدار كبير من الرمال في جنوب بحر الصين، وذلك يعني بحسب الخبراء أن الصين تبني مهابط الطائرات في جزر سبراتلي المتنازع عليها مع الفلبين، وهو نزاع لم يكن يحظى بأولوية حتى قامت واشنطن بالضغط على الحكومة في العاصمة الفلبينية مانيلا، وأطلق البنتاغون حملة دعائية تحت اسم حرية الملاحة. لكن ما يعني ذلك؟ يعني ببساطة حرية التجوال وسيطرة المقاتلات الأمريكية على الشواطئ في الصين. فتخيلوا ما سيكون رد الفعل الأمريكي إذا ما قامت المقاتلات الصينية بعمل مماثل مقابل الساحل في كاليفورنيا. مانويل أوكسنرايتر مدير المركز الألماني للدراسات الأوراسية ورئيس تحرير المجلة الشهرية الألمانية الرائدة سوئرست يحدثنا أكثر عن زياراته إلى مناطق الأزمات الجيوسياسية المتنوعة وعما لمسه وعن استنتاجاته، ولا سيما التغطية الإعلامية العالمية للأحداث هناك، وعن انتقادات بوتين للإعلام ونقله للأحداث، وإلى أي حد يعتقد أن وكالة الاستخبارات الألمانية هي فرع من وكالة الاستخبارات الأمريكية اليوم.
Manuel Oxenreiter, director of the German Center for Eurasian Studies and editor-in-chief of the leading German monthly news magazine, Zuerst. Welcome to Min al-Dakhl from the Inside, sir.
Thank you.
You're most welcome, sir. Manuel, as the director of the German Center for Eurasian Studies, please allow us to know more about this center and what does it promote?
Well, it is a very new center. We created it, or we founded it, in March 2016, and it is a reaction. Mm-hmm. It's a reaction against the German and against also European foreign policy, which is, in our opinion, directed against European interests. So our center is on the one side a think tank where we discuss certain ideas, especially ideas
connecting, what kind of ideas?
Connecting Europe with Asia. For example, one of the main hot topics since 2 or 3 years now are the German-Russian relations or the European-Russian relations, which are right
which
now...
Which is the subject and the topic of our interview today.
Yes, it is. Which we have now a confrontation by mm-hmm. the official politics, especially from Europe. And we think that cooperation is better than confrontation. So for this topic, we cooperate very closely with Russian counterparts. Mm-hmm. But not just that, we are not just a think tank, we are also an action tank. So we not just sit around and think smart and clever stuff and mm-hmm. enjoy ourselves by the thoughts. We also do activities.
One of these try to engage
exactly
more.
In mm-hmm. form of fact-finding missions, electoral observations, crisis monitoring missions, all this stuff, which is also done, for example, by organizations as the OSCE, But we have certain geopolitical hotspots where the OSCE is absolutely inactive.
Yes, in this sense, Manuel, you have been visiting, you have been going back and forth in visits to geopolitical crisis zones in different directions. Yes. Please, can you tell us where have you been, who did you meet, and what is the outcome and the conclusion that you came up with?
I will now start from German-centric, from Germany, the closest, and then to more far. We had different missions to Kosovo and to Bosnia, a former civil war or war country, which is now more or less peaceful, but where we have still a lot of conflicts. Kosovo is the black hole of Europe when it comes to organized crime, but also it is today one of the most active areas for recruitment for forms like ISIS, for example, for jihadism.
Extreme.
So this is in the heart of Europe. Other areas we have been, or I have been several times also as journalist, to Syria. 2 years ago we managed to go to Aleppo and to see how the situation is there. We have been, of course, Damascus, Homs, Hama, Latakia. So these spots we were able to visit. We've been in southern Caucasus, Armenia, Nagorno-Karabakh. Nagorno-Karabakh is a non-recognized republic. Many problems. We are eastern Ukraine in the two former, in the two self-declared republics of Lugansk and Donetsk. So Donetsk is a place I will go in September again for doing some projects there. We have been northern Caucasus, Chechnya, Dagestan. So all these more or less troubled areas are in our focus.
What is the core of your visit, Manuel, in this sense?
Well, the most important thing for us is always to understand. To understand what are the conflicts about and how is Europe and how especially Germany is involved in these conflicts. We have to do this because we cannot trust our mainstream media. I will give you one example, and this is Syria. We have the so-called refugee wave, the refugee crisis in Europe, especially in Germany, is the core, the magnet of the refugee movement. And our Chancellor Angela Merkel always says, well, if you want to do something against the refugee wave, you have to work on the conditions why these people leave. So one could mean that Germany is a country which does something for peace in Syria, because also it's in our own interest. Nobody wants to have millions of refugees, so you create conditions that these people don't have to leave. Actually, we are doing the contradiction. Our politics is supporting terrorism in Syria. So that means the same politicians who are opening the borders for refugees are before the sponsors of those who bomb these people out of their houses. This is a thing you cannot read in any mainstream media in Germany, or also not in Europe. And there we see our point, first of all, to collect information, to collect this information in cooperation with local authorities, local journalists, local activists, and transport this information then to Germany, not just then in a think tank way, but in a very practical way, to inform oppositional politicians.
Yes, what about the conclusions that you came up with?
Sorry?
The main conclusion, the outcome of your visits?
The main conclusion is almost in every geopolitical hotspot the same. The main conclusion is that the geopolitical front lines, the big powers behind these geopolitical front lines, are almost always the same. So we have
the big powers.
We have the big, we have the conflict, the, if we want to say so, the ideological conflict between those who are for a unipolar liberal world power from the West, and we have on the other side those who are in support for a multipolar world power. Of course, this is now a very vague description. I don't want to say there's US, there's Russia, or there's US, there's Iran. These are two very fundamental different views on the world, which are opposing each other. We see connections between these different geopolitical hotspots and battlegrounds, and this is the most painful conclusion, we see always that our own entity, our own entities, our own players, Germany and also Europe, is supporting always the wrong side. Wrong geopolitically means it is the side which brings you losses, the side which makes yourself suffer, and the side which doesn't bring you benefit. Right is the side which is in your interest, and it is somehow like a magic spell. If it's in our interest, it is also in the interest of others.
which is also right for the people in this sense. Mm-hmm. Now, in a similar vein, you visited Donbass in Ukraine back in 2014. Kiev declared you a persona non grata, and you say that the time in Donbass was very impressive and that there are parallels between what is going on there and in other crisis zones, particularly in Syria. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Not just Donbass, also Kosovo, mm-hmm. also southern Caucasus, also the battleground of Nagorno-Karabakh and surrounding, all we have their connections. I will give one example for such a connection. If you remember when the Russian Air Force started its bombardment missions in Syria against the terrorists, it was Ukraine and it was the Ukrainian state which was publishing the names and the faces of the pilots, of the Russian pilots. So they were directly helping the terrorists of the Islamic State. It was the Ukrainian government which opened the borders for terrorists from Chechnya, for example, and also for Tatarian terrorists to fight on the side of Ukraine against the so-called pro-Russian separatists on Donbas side. Chechenians who maybe fought before in Syria and before this in the two Chechenian wars until 1999 in the Chechenian Republic. So we see that there are connections between all these fields. We see that people who were fighting in Ukraine go to fight in Syria, go to fight in Iraq. There are volunteer units which were fighting, for example, in the Ukrainian war in 2014 on the side of the Ukrainian government against the Russians and who are fighting today in northern Iraq on the side of the Kurds, mm-hmm. for example, and supporting mm-hmm. the Kurds. So we have a mobility, and it's interesting on both sides of these front lines, of people who are changing the hotspots to fight
right.
here and mm. there. And when it comes to Donbas, of course the Ukrainian government doesn't like what we are doing there, that we are in support for groups they declare as terrorists and as separatists. But we are not just, or I'm not just persona non grata in Ukraine, I'm also persona non grata in Azerbaijan, and someone told me once that I shouldn't go to Georgia as well. So these are things, they come and go. I believe that this might change, in a couple of years it changes.
But you are most welcome in Lebanon.
Yes,
always.
Still.
Now,
thank you.
Russian President Vladimir Putin, who was meeting with foreign journalists at the conclusion of the St. Petersburg International Economic Forum last June, has railed against the journalists for their tall tales in blindly repeating lies and misinformation provided to them by the U.S., on its anti-ballistic missile systems being constructed in Eastern mm-hmm. Europe, that they are helping the journalist to push the planet towards a World War III. As a journalist, how did you read Mr. Putin's statements specifically now?
I think that Vladimir Putin understood already long before that the informational warfare mm-hmm. is conducted by the West now since a long time, and it's very professionalized. That means the Western mainstream journalists play the role as information soldiers, and we see this especially when we look in the media, the yellow press media, not because yellow press is so primitive, but yellow press has the biggest contact numbers with the citizens. And when I look, for example, in Germany, in the biggest newspaper, the Bild Zeitung, yellow press, it is a non-stop warmongering against the Russian Federation. Hate mongering against Vladimir Putin, with not on behalf of German interests, but on behalf of so-called Western interests. It is the fight for the free world, for the liberal free values of the West against the evil Eastern primitive tribes, a little bit like this. So it has always the narrative of Lord of the Rings when, mm-hmm. when we read these newspapers. And of course, when it comes to weaponry systems and missile systems, so seriously our media wants to tell us on the one side that we need these NATO missile systems in Eastern Europe necessarily because there is mm-hmm. evil Putin right about to conquer us. On the other hand, NATO nonstop tells the Russian Federation that these missile systems are not directed against the Russian Federation, but against Iran. Mm-hmm. So that is all ridiculous. And it is only then ridiculous if we don't understand the job of information warriors.
Right. Manuel, allow us to stop now for a short break. And after the break, we're going to talk about a similar parallel campaign, also Western media, mainstream media, a campaign against China.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but after the break, in the fasil qasir wa na'ud. Let it go by then.
يجعل احتمال نشوب حرب شاملة أكثر خطورة هو حملة إعلامية موازية ضد الصين، إذ قلما يمر يوم من دون أن تتحدث وسائل الإعلام في الغرب عن الصين لكونها تهديداً. مانويل أوكسنرايتر مدير المركز الألماني للدراسات الأوراسية، كيف يقرأ هذا السياق؟
This is because China is indeed a threat to the Western hegemonial project. We have China as a threat because China conducts another life model, which is in several fields contrary to the Western liberal model. The Western leaders tell us there cannot be any other model than the Western model. Any other model will sooner or later fail. So we have other models which don't fail. We have the Russian model. We have also the model of the Islamic Republic, for example, in Iran, which is also a non-Western model. And we have the Chinese model, where we have a sort of communist state with a limited market, where our Western scholars tell us this cannot exist, but it exists and it's very successful. So indeed, it is a threat. It is a threat for the mindset. Mm-hmm. This is the most important thing. But of course, we have to translate this for the people. People are not, people would say, okay, they think different, why should this be a danger? So we have to create dangers, even if there is not a danger. And I will give you an example, which is one of the newest campaigns in Europe. In Czech Republic, the president, Zeman, was doing some very, very good deals with Chinese industry and Chinese ministries for his country. Very good deals. Czech Republic is one of the economically weakest countries in the European Union, and they went to China and they went into good deals. So this is a thing the West doesn't like. The guys in Brussels don't like this, Berlin, and of course not in Washington. So what happened after this? All of a sudden news popped up. 60 Christian Chinese asylum seekers came to Czech Republic claiming for political asylum because they are persecuted because of their religious freedom. So what do we have? Asylum seekers going to Czech Republic. This is one of the last states an asylum seeker goes. They come all to Germany, Sweden, mm-hmm, France, mm-hmm, well, mm-hmm. The country. Then nobody knew about this. The narrative was pushed. Of course, there were 60 Chinese people claiming political asylum, but nobody saw them. So it was just a file.
It fabricated.
Well, maybe the people exist, but it's a file, but nobody, they were not in TV, but they, all of a sudden, some NGOs popped up. This was the Christian Lawyers, mm-hmm. NGO for pro-refugee NGOs and so on. And they started stressing the topic. They
said, the humanitarian issue.
The humanitarian issue. They said, look, there's China, which is persecuting Christians so brutally that they come to us, to Czech Republic, to seek refuge, asylum and security. And our president, this evil Zeman, is going to do business with those people who are torturing and persecuting Christians. So you see how an information campaign goes on.
Yes. Manuel, what is going on in Germany? According to a news report in the June 7th German Economic News headlined, Merkel ousts BND, US to control German espionage, a new law will soon be passed in the German parliament and be approved by Chancellor Angela Merkel, which will make Germany's version of the CIA, which is the BND, mm-hmm. nothing more than a branch of the CIA. How accurate is this report, and to what extent do you think that BND is a branch of the CIA today?
I think this report is not so accurate because the BND was founded as a branch of the CIA. So this is not a SWIFT or something. It is a very official thing that the BND from the beginning, of course there were time periods when the BND was acting more independently, but lately the BND was not able to protect Germany. I mean, what is a foreign secret service? It is to collect information about the enemies of the country, mm-hmm. and to defend and to defend
the interests, security.
The national security. When we see that the NSA was able to listen to the phone calls of millions of Germans, including our Chancellor Angela Merkel, mm-hmm. we ask ourselves, what for do we have a foreign intel service when it doesn't defend us against these attacks? The problem is that Angela Merkel and the Berlin government have a blind eye when it comes to our allies. So they always look, what is China doing? What is US doing? What is Iran doing? But they don't see the vast espionage activities of Israel, of France, of UK, of America in Germany. So if we face a real security threat, it is coming from these countries, and right now not from Russia or from China. China's mm-hmm. doing industrial espionage. They were always doing this. But the real danger for our information security is in fact coming from the US, and it's becoming more and more because the US is more and more not anymore convinced that mm-hmm. we are loyal partners. I can just
so
say
do you think
God.
Here that Germany is in a dilemma when it comes to the US, when it comes to Russia, because German Foreign Minister Frank-Walter Steinmeier mm-hmm. said recently that Germany would consider easing sanctions on Russia gradually if there is substantial progress on the issue of Ukraine. And we know that Russia is not going to change its stance, not an iota, when it comes to Ukraine.
The German leadership in general is in a dilemma. It's always the same dilemma. They have two interests. There are two interests, and these interests are in 99% of all cases contradicting each other. The first is the interest of the country, of the people, of our industry, also our business, of our security. Mm-hmm. This is interest number one. And interest number two is the so-called transatlanticist alliance or catalog of values. So the longer World War II is in the past, the more these two concepts contradict each other. Mm. Angela Merkel has literally to choose every day if she serves German interest or her American puppet masters. And unfortunately, she always decides for the Americans. When it comes to the Russian sanctions, and this is said in one sentence, the country suffering most under the sanctions against Russia is in fact Germany. So we can say that the anti-Russian
sanctions...
And the
economy in Germany.
Absolutely, yes. 300,000 jobs in Germany rely on the business with the Russian Federation. Thousands of companies and businessmen are cooperating with each other. This is really a neck shot. This is a neck shot for the German industry if this goes on like this. And the Americans don't care about their own sanctions. The Americans are doing business. They are doing this. So we can say that...
But is Berlin today performing a balancing or playing a balancing part between Moscow and the West?
They could and mm. they should, mm. but they don't do. Angela Merkel don't do it. If she would say today, we lift the sanctions with Russia, even by keeping our political criticism against Russia, but we lift the sanctions, what should the Americans do?
Mm-hmm.
Nothing.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't bombard us for that. They did this already in 45. Mm-hmm. But what should they do? Nothing. So and the effect would be, if Germany would say today, we lift the sanctions, that all the other European countries would follow Germany.
Of course.
But the same in the other way, as long Angela Merkel says, no, we need the sanctions because Russia is still occupying Crimea and they are doing bad stuff, as long the others will also follow us. And this is the bad thing of being part of the of leadership, Germany in Europe.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Right. Manuel Augustin, writer, director of the German Center for Eurasian Studies and editor-in-chief of the leading German monthly news magazine, Zuerst. Many thanks indeed for joining us, and you'll be joining us next week to talk a bit further about the EU, the fragility of the EU, and the more geopolitics in Germany today. إذن اللقاء يتجدد في الأسبوع المقبل للحديث أكثر عن الاتحاد الأوروبي وعن الجيوسياسة في ألمانيا اليوم. إذن للمزيد من التواصل بريدنا theinside@almayadeen.net وصفحتنا على الفيسبوك من الداخل من كل فريق من الداخل من كل الميادين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.